I would like to welcome the management and thank them for giving us the opportunity. I would now hand over the floor to Mr. Goyal for his opening remarks. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Harsh. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you, all of you, have received the investors' note already. Let me just speak on high-level numbers. The revenue growth during the quarter on comparable basis, adjusting for excise recovery, was muted at 2.6% against a strong previous year last quarter. On the positive side, however, the revenue this quarter has recovered and grown by 5.6% over the preceding Q3. While India suffered the continued impact of GST transition during the early part of Q4, the rest of the world sales grew to 7.2% over the preceding Q3. The main driver here is Europe, which posted 18.8% growth, helped by strong recovery in our German operations. As you all know, Europe had been the main drag on our sales growth for most of this financial year. For the full year, the revenue grew by 5.3% on comparable basis, adjusting for excise recovery. In constant currency terms, the growth was higher at 7.7%. GST-linked offtake drop in India and degrowth in Europe in the first three quarters were the key dampener for our growth aspirations for this year. With the GST transition having stabilized, we are seeing traction in the non-oral care category sales and hope to see India back on growth track, helped by recovery in the FMCG demand. In the light of recovery in German sales since January and more robust new business pipeline, Europe looks poised to post growth going forward. The East Asia Pacific has seen the key oral care customer demand stabilized in the last two quarters after a prolonged period of degrowth. Their non-oral care business continued to post growth and at 27% of EAP revenue is well set to drive growth in the region. America's region has secured new business awards which are under commercialization in the US and Mexico. The Colombia operation is being closely monitored and is showing clear signs of recovery. All this should drive America growth in the year ahead. In sum, disappointing as it was from revenue growth point of view, financial year 18 has been a time for us to recharge and regroup too. The EBITDA margin for the quarter was at 18.7%, lower by 80 basis points compared to Q3, impacted mainly by product mix and inventory correction at year end in the EAP and Americas. EBITDA margin for the full year, in fact, expanded by 110 basis points to 19.5% on account of operational efficiencies and several cost-saving programs. It is to be noted that the full-year EBITDA of rupees 473 crores represents a healthy year-over-year growth of 11.4%. In a year, we faced challenges on the revenue front. The PAT for the year before exceptional item on account of closure of Egypt subsidiary is rupees 176.6 crores compared to 174.7 crores of last year. Higher forex loss of approximately 5 crores and the impact on effective tax rate of Poland underperformance were the dampeners of the PAT growth year over year despite a 11.4% EBITDA growth. Our current healthy margin coupled with the prospects sales growth mentioned earlier should bring PAT growth to track our Mission 2020 and with that improved the ROCE and ROE, which now stands at 16.8% and 15% respectively. The balance sheet continues to be strong, with the net debt reducing by rupees 140 crores over the year, helped by a strong free cash flow. The capex for the year was proactively calibrated to the evolving demand during the year and contained at rupees 120 crores, whereas our depreciation was at about 167 crores, well below the depreciation. Interest cost has been contained below 6% at exit. Debt equity ratio and debt service coverage ratio are healthy at 0.59 and 2.2 respectively, making for financial flexibility to seize any new growth opportunity. Overall, we believe the fundamental points to the business getting back to the double-digit growth trajectory we are confident about. Now, with that, I will open the floor for question and answer.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. We take the first question from the line of Bharti Mundra from CD Research. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I would like to know how would the U.S. administration's inward-looking trade policy impact your business going ahead?
I'm sorry, I missed your name, ma'am.
Bharti.
Bharti. Okay. Bharti, it's a good question. I was asked by the media, one of the media channel this morning. I think on the FMCG sector and the packaging sector that we operate in, we do not expect any impact on so-called global trade war. If at all, we should only benefit because current administration in U.S., which is pushing for Make in U.S., that should only help us in terms of lower imports from other countries, particularly China, of the items that we make. And therefore, that should only help us in U.S. Whereas we don't operate in that space from China in our Chinese operations.
Okay, but will this not have any impact on our revenues and the business that we get from America?
Because we manufacture in America, so it will only help us, right?
All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sameer Gupta from Indian Flying. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. This is Percy here. So I was just looking at the difference in your net fixed assets as you have reported in your results release, and I'm adding back depreciation. So that would basically derive the capex, and I'm getting capex of 200 crore as per that method versus 120 crore which you just spoke in the call. So can you just let me know the reconciliation for these two numbers?
Yes, Ganesh will explain that.
Yeah, can you hear me, Percy?
Yes.
Okay, what we have put in the balance sheet will be in terms of what are the additions to capex, right? And what we are explaining to you is the actual spend during the year as per the cash flow statement.
Oh, I see. Okay. So on accrual basis, it is indeed 200 crores, but on cash basis, it is 120 crores. Is that understanding correct?
No, it is not accrual. It is what is commissioned. You see what happens when
Okay.
is spent. These projects take various time period. to complete. So then they are carried through, and then once the project is complete, they get capitalized. So at that time, in the balance sheet, we include it as an addition to
block,
right? So what we have been always tracking is in terms of how much we spend. The whole idea is that whatever the depreciation is there, that's the cash accruing into the business, which is what we deploy for growth as capex.
So can you give me an idea the rough breakup of this 120 crore for which facilities you have incurred and whether there is any greenfield or brownfield?
Yeah. So last year, most of the spending is, has been on the brownfield. So it has been spread in two areas. One in India. We had some expansion in WADA. We had some injection molding capability which was built in WAPI, right? And then there are a couple of tubing lines which we added. Then also there was some spending in the U.S. On the decoration capability. And in China. China, we also invested in a lot of tooling flexibility because as we are expanding into the non-oral care, it gives us that added advantage to be able to offer a shorter lead time to our customers.
So would India be like more than 50% of the total capex, or how is it like distributed?
Yeah, India would be around 60 crores in terms of spend. Yeah.
Okay, so half would be in India, and then second highest would be US, and third would be China. Is that correct?
That's right. Yes, correct.
Okay.
And you would recall also, Percy Ashokji mentioned last time during 17-18. Lot of our spend has gone on creating capability because there were capacity due to the past expansion. So it was a capability and creating flexibility in our production base.
Okay. So second question on Europe. Basically, if I see the constant currency numbers in Europe, we have actually declined in terms of sales. And Europe has now been a sort of problem area for now 4 or 5 quarters in terms of getting into positive territory adjusted for inorganic portion. And if I recall correctly, the initial thought process was that Europe is actually going to be a growth market and the fastest growth among all the four geographies will come from Europe. So just wanted to understand what went wrong and what visibility do you have in terms of improvement and what are the timelines by which we can see this improvement?
Yeah, Percy. And as I mentioned in the opening remarks, Germany was the main dampener for Europe, which for the Q4, from February of last financial year, they have bounced back. So we believe that Germany should continue to track and if at all should only grow from the original base. Original base when I say is what was the base when we acquired the company and after acquiring it had degrown. So that now has been arrested. Poland, we don't see any major issue except that the contracted customer there, their offtake has been low, which was not really projected by the customer. And even in the last con call, I had mentioned that we may be required to balance some capacities in the plastic tube capacities because some of the lines are old and the business growth that is happening, we will rather invest in pre-owned equipments. So that has not happened. So fundamentally what I'm saying is the Europe was kind of a slopey in terms of what they were telling and what they were achieving or what they actually achieved, not achieving or they were not lying about what they were achieving, but there was a mismatch between what they said they will achieve and what they actually achieved. So that was the challenge, and this year we have sensitized the leadership very clearly and we see much improved tracking of how the pipelines are being tracked and addressed, and we are monitoring it from here. And this year we believe, and they are also very confident that they will grow double digit.
Yeah.
Europe will also grow double digit in this financial year.
So this double digit growth, is it on the back of any new sort of client acquisitions, or the existing clients client base itself can give that double digit growth?
Mix of both, Percy. The existing client base is the number of projects they are running is expanding, and also new customers are getting added.
Okay, the only reason I asked is new customer acquisition, you can never be sure, right, whether you will be able to acquire or not. So if that doesn't pan out, then the existing customers, based on the visibility of orders that they tentatively sort of give at the beginning of the year, you would have some visibility on what kind of sales growth can happen through that sort of route?
Yeah, so there's two part to your question. One is that what happened last year is true, and there was a misalignment, as I mentioned in the last call also. Misalignment in terms of what process we follow globally and what we finally discovered they were following in Europe in terms of customer growth. So that mismatch has been aligned, first of all. Now, after having aligned the growth pipeline, we normally take the strike rate not more than 30%. So second part, you're right in your statement, which I'm confirming, and also telling you what is our solution to that. So once, if we target, let's say, 30 or let's say 100, then the pipeline has to be more than 300. And that's how we are now tracking, and therefore that uncertainty gets kind of absorbed.
Understood, sir. Understood. My question was, slightly different and rather specific, that supposing, just hypothetically, there are no new customer additions, then from the existing customers itself, what kind of growth can you generate in Europe? Can it be like 5% or 10%, or the existing customers are not growing at all?
No. I think I have to go into the fundamental of the business strategy in that case. irrespective whether the category is growing or not growing. Also, let's assume that the economies are also not growing. Our growth strategy is not dependent on category or the economic growth. Our growth is strategy is based on the shift of packaging format from plastic tubes and bottles and aluminium tubes to laminated tubes. So that's our fundamental growth strategy, and which is why we feel confident that there might be some hiccup here and there, but fundamentally this strategy is still very sound. So only thing is that we have to get more and more projects from the same customer, irrespective whether that customer is growing or not. Are we able to convince the customer to shift from plastic tubes to laminated tubes? Are we able to convince the same customer to move some of their existing SKUs, which might be in bottles, to laminated tubes, and some of the existing SKUs, which might be there in aluminium tubes, to laminated tubes?
Right, sir. Very clear. Thanks and all the best. I'll come back in the queue. I have a few more questions, but I'll give other people a chance to ask.
Thank you, Percy.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, I would like to remind all the participants, if you have a question, you may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. We take the next question from the line of Jignesh Makwana from Asian Market Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity.
Excuse me, sir. I'm sorry to interrupt, but requesting you to please speak a bit louder. If you can please use your handset.
Is it audible now?
Yeah, better.
Yeah. So just a few quarters back, you were mentioning that the market share erosion for leading customers in China has been almost over, but still we are not seeing any improvement in EAP business. If you can elaborate the same. And second thing, on India business, despite a low base of last year, the post-demonetization quarter and everything, still we have been very muted numbers. I understand there was a bit of disturbance in supply chain because of change in GST rate, but still, even after factoring that, we have muted performance for last two quarters. So if you can comment on that also. Thank you.
Roy Joseph will answer on India, then I'm not clear about your China question, so we'll ask you later.
Yeah, so this it is on India part, we have two aspects. One, we have the GST which kicked in July, and post that, towards end of November, and we had the cosmetic category which had higher GST, attracted higher GST rates, which was in July, which was announced. And post that, there was a revision to that towards end of November, where the rates were again revised to on a lower side. So there was a lot of disruption in the supply chain, and we saw volumes for the beauty and cosmetic segment lower from December to January and mid of February, because brands were repacking and resizing their products. So this is one aspect that impacted especially the cosmetic sales for us. And on the pharma side, we can say that although we have gone for acquisition and getting new customers primarily on conversion from aluminium to DAMI, the portion of exports that happened from India to the developed regulated markets, we saw some traction, reduction there, because of pricing pressures that our customers are facing. So that doesn't impact the overall pharma growth for us in India, because we have a very strong pipeline for conversions as well as acquisitions for this category of pharma. So it was primarily, I would say, the cosmetics, which there was the entire brands went for redesign and artwork calibration to meet the new GST norms which were announced towards the end of November. And the entire phase-in, phase-out for supply chain in FMCG takes around 45 days, and that's what impacted. But we could see from mid-February, strong traction, good growth for both the cosmetic segment and growth coming from the pharma from conversions.
And Q1 in India is always soft.
Yeah, so the other aspect is to compare the Q4 numbers, that is the quarter four numbers, are muted. Our peaks are basically in Q3 and Q2 for India.
So can we expect a low double-digit growth from Indian market given the low base and now the improved traction in pharma and cosmetic both?
Yeah, we can expect the double-digit growth for India in the coming quarters, primarily because of one is the low base, and also because of the new business acquisitions that we have made, especially in the pharma space.
Okay. And second, on China, what I was asking, a couple of quarters, you were mentioning about market share erosion for your customers in China has been arrested, but still we have not witnessed any material improvement in EAP business.
Yeah, so that statement is correct, that the contracted customers that we had in China, they were constantly dropping, losing market share, which has been arrested, which is a fact. Now that means that only the bad news doesn't come further. Now we are looking for good news. So good news was, we were looking for was some of the local customers win, which we have. But unfortunately with those customers, the credit, what do you call credit? The credit risks that we have with them is the balancing act that we have to do with respect to whether we give priority to the sales or ensuring that the money is safe. So that balancing act we keep doing. So if China in last 2-3 years has been actually degrowing. So at least this year they have grown positively. And their growth for the year is 6.8% on constant currency. Their growth in non-oral care has been, most of this growth has come from non-oral care, and their non-oral care base is still very small, which is about 27% of their sales, I think.
Yes.
So our efforts are on non-oral care. There are some new wins that China has on non-oral care. We are waiting for the commercialization to happen. And what is special about EAP in China is that that the volatility between the quarters are high.
Okay.
One, because they have two lunar holidays,
festivals.
Mm-hmm. Right? So in those two quarters, obviously, they lose about seven, eight days of working. So that's one of the reason, and therefore EAP quarter over quarter may not be the right criteria for us to judge them. Rather, we look at on a full year basis how the geography is done.
Okay, and if you can provide us how much revenue we are deriving from the local customers in China.
That breakup, Jignesh, we don't have offhand. We can give you offline if you want.
Sure, definitely.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's it from my side.
Yeah.
Thank you. A reminder to all the participants, if you have a question, you may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. We take the next question from the line of Sameer Gupta from Indian's Line.
Hi, sir. This is Percy here. Just wanted to understand with crude price going up, is there any risk to your bottom line?
I'll let Ramasamy answer that question.
Percy, this is, we explained in many calls, this is, we will always be, most of the things are contractual, we will catch up, but there's a time lag between price rise versus the actual oil price rise, polymer rise, then we recover from the customer. There will be a time lag, but it, more or less it is secured. That's how the business normally happens. But there's a time lag.
How much is that time lag approximately?
Anywhere between 3 months.
So the time lag is 3 to 6 months, depending on different geographies, the contract terms we have. But as of now, we have seen price rise from, if we take the base of December last year, so price rise has been about 5%.
3%.
About 3% so far in terms of polymer, which is not significant. which is why you would see some of the inventory build-up has taken place up to March in anticipation that the prices may harden. So in March quarter, you have seen the inventory levels have risen up in India and China. So we try to soften that blow a little bit, but it, so far as the prices of polymer has not moved in line with the polymer oil prices.
And why do you think that may be the case?
That I think I explained in the past also, as that between oil and the polymer, there are other building blocks, that is naphtha and ethylene. Each one has their own orbit, so to speak, in the sense that the demand and supply from oil is different for naphtha. So therefore, it sort of revolves around in a different orbit. And then from naphtha, which is the building block for ethylene, again hovers in a different orbit, which means it has again its own demand and supply gap issues, and therefore the price movements. And then comes the petrochemicals, which is polyethylene or polyethylene in our case. So therefore there could be a time lag. But if you plot all this on a longer period horizon of 3 years, then you would find the movement is same.
Understood. So then historically, over the last like 10-15 years, what has been your experience that does high polymer prices affect your volume growth positively or negatively?
I don't think it has an impact on volume. What it does is that it increases or decreases my revenues. If I have asked, for example, if I am currently selling at price X and polymer price have moved by 10% and I ask for price increase by 5% because my value addition is, let's say, give and take 50%. So 5%, so my sales revenue becomes 105. Right, while I keep the same margin, so margin remains the same, but my margin percentage comes down a little bit.
Understood, sir.
And take the reverse, if the polymer prices drops by 10%, then my price revenue become 95 instead of 100. I lose the revenue, but my and margin remains the same, but percentage profit improves. So that's the volatility. Other than that, it doesn't impact.
Right, sir. And just one quick question on China. Earlier, we used to have that problem in oral care where the local brands were growing faster than the MNC brands. So just wanted to understand what's happening on the ground and there. Are the local sort of toothpaste brands still growing faster than MNC, or that now the growth has more or less equalized?
So let's talk about this in China terms, and let's also talk about, because I think it's relevant, on a global terms. In China terms, for oral care, if your question is specific, then we believe that last year, China toothpaste market has contracted by 1%. That means it has decreased by 1%. So obviously nobody is now growing or nobody is now losing. But what is also happening is that we have to keep in mind this, and this is true in global context also, that new distribution channels or the method, which in essential terms we are talking about in essence, is the e-commerce business. E-commerce business is a big disruptor globally as far as supply chain is concerned. The established brands are struggling to compete with the just mushroom brand, and they just launched it on the e-commerce and they are successful. They have, and by the time the established brands come to know, it is year and a half that what has hit them. So that's a new reality that we are facing, some geography increasingly so, some geographically not so increasingly, and different products have different trajectory, so to speak. We were having a meeting with some strategic partners beginning of this week, and they were sharing with us what's happening for beer market in U.S., Now, all of a sudden, there is so much of draft beer brands that have come up in U.S. That the established brands are now suffering and they don't even know what has hit them until year has gone by, year and a half has gone by. And by the time they react, things have changed again. So the new distribution channels have become a disruptor generally. So that was the beer example, but for FMCG, again, depending on where the millennial population is calling the short or the highest, which obviously are in the emerging markets, the disruptions are greater. And while the big giants are grappling with solutions in understanding first and then how to respond, the small brands are going to be the reality. So that is a challenge, and therefore, it is becoming difficult even for us how much weightage we give on the customer forecast, and which is why we see that volatility is increasing in terms of what we thought that we will do versus what we did. and the categories in which we did. So that has posed some challenges to us, and therefore we are also internally have deliberated already and are working on long-term solutions. Long-term meaning that we have to start doing that now and start using some newer technologies now and processes, so that we are ready when it really becomes a way of life. So that is in some sense of how the market disruption is taking place.
Sir, what new technology can you adopt in this if basically e-commerce is taking share or small brands are taking share? Can you just elaborate on that point? You said you can adopt some new technologies to sort of save yourself against this disruption.
Yeah, so basically the answer, I will not tell you how, but I'll tell you what. What is that? How do I make my processes react faster?
Okay.
Right? And then I have to identify what are my bottleneck processes or capacities or the technology, and then how do I address that?
Understood, sir. In EAP, could you split up your oral and non-oral care growth for FY18, sir? How much is it?
I'll depend on Vinay. Vinay?
The revenue growth in EAP for FY18 is 3.8%. And non-oral care growth is 2.7%.
Sorry, 3.8 is the total and 2.7 is non-oral care, is it?
2.7 is non-oral care, that is for full year. For quarter, non-oral care growth is 13.4%.
Okay, so for full year, oral and non-oral care have grown at approximately the same rate.
Yeah, about 3.5 you can say.
3.8 is the overall growth for the year, and 2.8.
So 3.8 is for oral care.
For oral care.
And 2.7 is for non-oral care for full year, and quarter non-oral care is 13.4%.
Okay, so for the quarter, non-oral care has grown faster.
And sir, any reason to believe that non-oral care in EAP will grow faster than oral care in the future?
Yes. Because that has been one, first of all, the EAP is the geography which has the lowest revenue share in non-oral care, which is 27%, so just half of our target, global target. So they have to catch up, and there is a huge market in China for non-oral care, huge consumption, and therefore, that's the way to go.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. I would like to remind all the participants, if you have a question, you may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. Reminder to the participants, if you have a question, please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. We take the next question from the line of Ritvik Seth from Deep Finance. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi. Good afternoon, sir. Hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. You mentioned that CapEx was 120 crore. So, is it safe to assume that, generally do an annual run rate of around 150 crores? So will that, this balance spill over in FY19?
Sorry, so if the capex was 120 last year, average is 150, what is the third part?
the balance 30-35 crores will spill over in FY19?
Yeah, that is a possibility, yes.
Okay, so this will include the capex that we are doing in Assam for the greenfield unit as well.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, and so what is the status at Assam? Like, where have we reached? Have we broken ground or throw some light?
I was there 2 weeks ago. I happened to be there, not that I was there.
Okay.
I think they are starting to erect the structure of the building.
Okay.
The ground, they have come up from the ground, which means that all the foundation and everything of all structures, all buildings, including gates and walls and everything, mm-hmm. has been done. So, and by the way, which I was not aware, monsoon in Assam starts in March, month of March.
Okay.
I was not aware of it until I went there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, obviously, they can continue to work because all the foundations, they have come, every structure has been built up to plinth level.
Okay.
So, monsoon will not interrupt, impact. And the structure is under erection, and I think power connection has been applied for. Recruitments have already started.
Consent to plate.
Some legal formalities of the state government are underway.
Mm-hmm.
So I think by July they will start production.
Oh, wow. In 3 months then.
Yeah.
That is pretty fast. Okay. Okay. And so you mentioned net debt we reduced by 150 crores. What is the net debt as on March 2018?
563 crores.
Okay. And so just going by the call, it looks like that worst is behind us in terms of, India after demon, GST, then channel restocking, this, that, worst is over for India and Europe as well. So do we expect strong double-digit revenue growth for these two and, overall for a consolidated group as a whole, low double digit for FY19 and 20?
FY19 double digit for sure, both top line and bottom line.
Okay.
20 we should be, logically speaking, but we don't have definitive answer.
Right.
I'm not saying yes or no.
Okay.
That doesn't mean my confidence level is not there.
Mm.
Just that we have not put the numbers together.
Sure. Okay, and so one last question, sir. Generally, whenever I have asked you about non-oral care, you have shied away. But this time, this is the first time that I'm hearing from your end. Some pharma wins in India, and you are excited about it. So, if you can throw some more light, because
this week I know you will come to this question.
Yeah, because every time I ask you, you generally shy away. So this is the first time that I'm hearing. So it sounds very positive going forward.
Yeah, so I can't still give you specific numbers, category-wise breakup.
Okay.
But the fact that it, all this new business reality is the expectation, or not the expectation, the work that the teams have put in the last 1 year or 2 years.
Mm.
Right? So based on which effort succeeded the best, that sets the tone for the current year or the next year's category growth.
Mm, okay.
And which is why we are able to say for definite that in India, pharma growth is likely to be the highest in this financial year.
Okay. So it's safe to assume that, say, in next 2 years' time, we should be going towards 45% non-oral care. From current 41%.
India is already at 50.
No, I'm saying for a group.
Well, that's the challenge that I always have, because we don't turn away any business. We don't stop pushing, hunting for more business in any category.
Hmm.
But yes, you're right. I think our growth in non-oral care should be faster than the oral care going forward. Yes.
Okay, so that's it, and all the best. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of August Tavay from CAO Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. So you, the way you described the challenges from the e-com and how the newer brands are creating problems for the older ones, So on the marketing side and on the sales side, how are you addressing that? Are you trying to get better access to these newer brands as your customers? What kind of strategy you have in place and what can you actually do? So that I understand that on your existing clients, the volatility of their projections, it has been pretty pretty high over the last 18 months at least. So my question is, how can you remove that from your business by addressing more and more from these new and upcoming brands, more business from these new and upcoming brands? Thank you, sir.
Yeah, great question, Dave. So the new brands that crop up and are able to market, brand themselves and market themselves with the speed, it's safe to assume that they will not have their own manufacturing.
Correct.
So when they don't have their own manufacturing, that means they are coming up with their own recipe with the existing manufacturers. And those existing manufacturers typically could be not the brand owning manufacturers, but what we call OEM, or the contract manufacturers. Right? So therefore, one of our efforts are to always scan who are the contract manufacturers in different markets.
Okay.
And therefore start pitching in with them, and the chances are most of the time, around 50% or so of the time, that who should be the supplier are chosen by the so-called OEM or contract fillers. And therefore, us being marketing them to them in advance helps us to capture the new brand also.
But sir, are your market shares similar in these contract manufacturers as it is with the bigger brands?
I'm not sure of that question and also the answer, because we haven't tracked the maybe Roy can answer that better.
In terms of the sales and marketing, the first point was on e-commerce, how it is actually being a disruptor. What I would like to say is that in terms of studies done on packaging, that we find a lot of shift because of the transportation that happens on e-commerce. Movement that happens from rigids to flexibles. A lot of you find items like shampoo bottles will actually go through redesign because of the logistic challenge of transporting. So, which is beneficial to products like tubes. So that is the first shift. If you look at the conventional retail, there's something called the first moment of truth, which means when the consumer picks up the tubes from the shelf. When we go to the e-commerce route, which is it's called the zero moment of truth, where basically the artwork, the customer is looking at the design online on his mobile or his laptop before he buys. So in terms of the design that are done are different because he's not looking at the real product, but he's looking at on a screen. So there is a shift in terms of design and the way it is looked at. So it's moving from first moment of truth to zero moment of truth when you go to the e-commerce route. Now, as far as SL's, SimplePack's way of working, we've been always working with smaller and brands as well as private labels in the conventional, business. So we are comfortable working with the private labels in the past. And when we see the smaller brands coming, we will actually use the same model to service them.
Why I wanted to understand this was that let's take a five-year view from today. And let's say what the problems that we face in the oral care client of ours in China. If such a situation were to replicate in any other geographies, have we learned the right lessons and have we taken the corrective action so that in case one of our established client actually loses market share to a newer brand, we can address that much more quickly? Because the Chinese situation took a long time to rectify. I know it has nothing to do with SL actually. You could not have reacted or anticipated such a thing. But in future, will our reaction times to such changes be better?
Yeah, so if you look at the case with, say, India, there has been a significant shift in terms of market shares of large brands, both in oral as well as non-oral care. And as a company, we've been able to, you know, adjust, and as newer brands come in, we've been able to service them. Now, we have a very large base of customers, so we have the experience in India of doing smaller customers. We have 440 active customers in India, and the list keeps on growing. So as a company, we have the knowledge to actually replicate that across all the geographies when the smaller brands come in play.
Okay. And sir, final question from my side. In such a situation, when you are servicing clients of different pedigree, different size and different geographies, are the economics significantly different? I mean, if you go for a newer, smaller client, do you charge them differentially compared to an older, larger client?
Well, the volume does play a role in deciding the price, my friend.
Okay.
So that, okay. I think, lesser said the better on this.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I get the point, sir. Thank you very much. Good luck, sir. Good luck.
Thank you. A reminder of the participants, if you wish to ask a question, you may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. Next question is from the line of Gautam Gupta from NRC Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. My question is, would you be able to share quantitative sales data, as in sales volumes, for the last 3 years? Maybe online or offline?
Quantitative?
Yeah.
I know what you're trying to do.
Yeah.
But I don't think it will be helpful because of just the quantitative data will not be helpful because the product mix would have changed in different years, category sales would have changed, and as you know, the price X of oral, 2.5X of pharma, 3.5X of That will not really help you build a model.
I think the only thing I was looking for is to see how the value addition maybe has changed, you know, year on year, because there's been such a fair amount of change in the
return on capital employed, no? Straight away.
Fair enough, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Vikas Sarda from India Asset. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, thank you. On the CapEx side, you mentioned that 120 crore was actual for FY18. What is the budget for FY19?
Well, budget is always same as depreciation, but this year we have a couple of projects which are strategic in nature. For example, we have in India, in Vasind plant, we are expanding the lamination facilities and building a new building, and we're getting a new machine on as well, which will be good enough for 4 billion of tubes or 5 billion of tubes. So therefore, these kind of investments we call strategic. We are expanding WADA further to be ready to be able to expand capacity. So there are some infrastructure projects that we have taken. There are some strategic investment that is happening this year. So it would be safe to say that this year's depreciation, which will be in the range of 167 crores, and plus the short spend of last year, will be added, and therefore around 200 crores should be the capex this year.
Okay, so say around 200 to 220 crore should be enough, right?
For this year, and then next year again we may come down to normal level.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of the capacity, I mean, where would you stand now, say, for double digits growth this year?
For capacity?
Yeah.
So as I think we it's standard for SL Propak is that and coupled with some other comments I had made in the past about the short line, the 500 cube line, right? So we are trying to see that where is the possibility of, if we have to, let's say, in three different geographies if let's say 500 cube per minute
line has a capacity of, let's say, 250 million tubes a year. I'm just picking up a number. It could be 200, it could be 250, let's say 250. Now, this 250 million capacity, I need to increase in three different geographies, for example. So then, obviously, I can't invest in one short line in any geography and starve the other two. Or I can't have the short line put in all three, and thereby increasing the capacity to 750, which doesn't make sense. So what we try to do is that we put this in one geography, and the excess capacity created in that geography should release some of the existing lower speed equipments, which can be easily used in the other two geographies. Yeah, so this is how we expand the capacities. And obviously then we will try to make, to draw benefits, like if I put this 250 million capacity in a geography where my labor cost is higher than the other two, I would obviously choose the first geography where the labor cost is high. And thereby reducing the cost there, and there is the normal cost. So these are few of the things that we plan in terms of capacity expansions whenever we think. And so there are a lot of moving parts even in that simplest of the decision that we take.
And sir, I mean, recently there was also release on this recyclable tubes. You mentioned that every tube can be recycled, and also in the past you mentioned that every tube that SL makes, you can promise it to be defect-free. So, I mean, all these the projects, I mean, when will you see some financial impact from these kind of initiatives?
Yeah, great question. So let me help you understand. There are three aspects of on this environment-friendly stuff. First is that plain and simple, we have developed a tube which is patent applied, is that made all these layers, and each tube, let's say generally speaking, some tubes have a 23 different layers, some tubes have not less than 13 different layers, so 1-3. So each layer is manipulated in a way which is made of a similar same family of the polymers. So therefore it becomes a one single recycling code. There are any packaging material you see, there are in the back, if you, most of you I'm sure currently have a water bottle in front of you. And if you pick up a bottle and see the bottom side of the bottle, there is a triangular arrow marks. If not in the bottom, then you certainly see on the label near the barcode, right? And that is supposed to say also a number in between. The one I'm holding doesn't say a number, but there are code numbers depending on what is the family of polymers that has been used. Okay. So in this case, we have developed a code to 100% recyclable tubes, so you don't have to do anything. You simply put them in the recycling stream. That's the most difficult but the simplest explanation. The second part we have done is that we have developed tubes which are called ETN, that is environmentally sustainable. So we have branded it like a ETN. Which has a 25% to 35% of post-consumer recycled material used in the making of tubes. So that means we have reduced the demand of the virgin polymers by 25% to 35%. So that's the second. The third is that we have a tube which also has a polymer, but also has the aluminum foil as a barrier layer. That is the most challenging one in terms of recycling. And therefore, we've been working, our R&D teams have been working on finding a solution to that in terms of recycling, not
of course, we will continue to find solution for replacing aluminum altogether. But while we do that, market also has to accept. So we have identified, finally put together a couple of small different technologies, bundled them together in a way that we can separate the plastic and the aluminum separately, which are bonded so strongly together. And that has been a challenge. We finally cracked it. And this will be, we have named it, codenamed it as Liberty, Project Liberty.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, SL is not investing in the final investment. It's a third party on the assurance from SL Propack that we will make sure that it is economically viable for them. So we are helping them select the technology. We will first start with our own factory scraps to be recycled through this process. And after that, we will offer this to the brands that if they wish to collect the post-consumer empty tubes, we are willing to take them and recycle it for them. And once we are successful here in India, we will launch it globally. So that's how we are making sure that anything that is produced by SL doesn't go in landfill or in burning or any of such thing. All of it should go into recycling.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we are doing, and therefore we do not expect it to have any financial impact on SL Propack in negative way. Because I personally am of the firm belief that any recycling efforts are economically viable, provided one has selected, identified, developed the right technology, and have set, have designed their project well.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Well, that seemed to be the last question. I now hand the floor back to the management for their closing comments.
So thank you really very much. As always, appreciate your good questions. To whoever we could not answer the question immediately, you're welcome to ask us back. You can reach out to Amit Jain or Ganesh. Or to any one of us. So thank you really very much. All the best.
Sure. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of